All right, guys, thanks very much. I'm down here on the track with head coach Danny Calgill out of Daphne, Alabama, defensive coordinator down there during the when you're not here. Coach, talk a little bit about what you've seen from your team this week heading into this first game this morning.
Well, the goal was to improve them fundamentally throughout the whole process. That way they can go back no matter what scheme they run. It's still blocking and tackling and defeating blocks. So depending on what scheme they run back at home, they'll get better, you know, in the fundamental aspects, blocking, tackling, and shedding blocks.
Is it sometimes a challenge since they already know maybe one offense, teaching them another offense here or something like that? Or do you ever encounter some type of problem where they might not be able to ingest all the information you're teaching them here at the USA football camp?
You know, reach block is a reach block. A trap block is a trap block. A nine route, a post route, that's all the same. Now, I may call it tomato, they may call it tomato. But once we get through that terminology barrier, football's football.
And last question, Coach, who surprised you this week in your teachings?
There's young man Brian Bond playing defensive line, and he's going to be a good football player. Terrell Lindsey is a free safety for us, outstanding player. And we got a running back, Golick, that's pretty shifty dude. You know, our coaching staff, I'll tell you, they have done a great job. The Spinner brothers, Tyree, RG, Bryson, they're local guys. And I'll tell you what, I think those guys have an advantage now because they are a sharp bunch of guys. Then, you know, I got Tommy Polly, Coach A, Chad Louisville. Those guys have done a great job. All I had to do was referee arguments.
Coach Danny Calgo, thank you so much. Enjoy the first game.
You got it. Appreciate it.
All right. Back to you guys.
We are live at Johnny United Stadium on the campus of Towson University in Baltimore, Maryland for USA Football's 2015 Development Games. Of course, our first matchup today will pit Chris Merritt's white team versus Danny Calgill's red squad. Hi, football fans. I'm Jeremy Huber, joined by my broadcast partner for today, Emery Hunt. And Emery, of course, folks tuning into this matchup, maybe not knowing exactly what it is when we come to these games. Basically, it's the last step before these kids can make the U.S. national team.
And this is a great opportunity for these guys to showcase their skill set in front of a bunch of coaches, a bunch of other players, or guys across the country to get to that USA team that's going to play next year in Texas.
Yeah, and should be a fun game. A lot of guys looking for a spot on this team, looking to show off their wares, as you said, and just looking to play some football. These kids just love the game of football.
Like I said, this has to be fun for these guys, being out there, putting on Team USA's colors, being able to play in front of a great crowd here today at Towson University.
And with that, let's go ahead and take a look at our players to watch in this one. Of course, our team for Team White, brought to you by Siege Sports, the official uniform provider of the U.S. national teams.
Well, you look at Jonathan Speltz, running back, outstanding player. Got the chance to see him yesterday at practice. Great speed, great footwork. Interested to see him out here today against the red team.
And, of course, you see the guys on the red squad as well. Jared Wagenhofer, a good quarterback there. Jaden Brunson as well. A lot of good guys on both of these squads. Flipping it over now, looking at our coaching staff. Those sponsored, brought to you by Just Play. Just Play, our sponsor of our coaching staffs today.
Great staff here. You see Johns Hopkins University, well represented. And that's a pretty good football team at the Division III level. Outstanding program. And they should have a good season this year. No, the big reason why is they're well coached.
And, of course, Columbus High School's Chris Merritt, been with the USA football program since really its inception. Let's switch it over and look at our coaching staff for Coach Calgill's team.
Well, you look at Tommy Powley's the big name right there, the former NFL player of the St. Louis Rams, doing a great job coaching those guys down at St. Francis Academy.
And, of course, as you see, a lot of guys from Avalon School, one of the schools, pretty good program in the Washington, D.C. area. So definitely some good coaches that these guys are learning under. And, of course, that means a lot when you come out here. You'll want to go ahead and learn from the best.
Exactly.
Now, you look at the white team getting ready to take it out on the field. Of course, very special here being USA football. They have the flag that they bring out as well. That honor going to Ryan Wheaton, a number 78, but also the captains for this squad, Ben Tauber, Brandon White, Eric DeMeo, and Michael Kurczewski. Also on the other side of things, you see the red team over there, coached again by Danny Calgill, their flag bearer, number 11, Gerald Filardi Jr. And interestingly, with Gerald Filardi Jr., that name might ring a bell to some folks. His father was a linebacker at Penn State.
Right, and you know Penn State is what, linebacker. You don't want to tick off anybody out there, but they have produced some really good linebackers over the course of their history.
Most definitely, but interestingly, and I'm sure though his dad, I believe, is his coach, he is a guy who, as a coach, was a linebacker, but his kid's a quarterback. So, again, he probably isn't that excited his kid's a quarterback, but maybe he is because he's the one coaching him. But, again, really excited to look at this game today as we see. What are some things you're looking forward to, Emery?
I'm looking for a clean game, how well these guys play with great technique. They've been coached up well all week long, and technique is big here with USA football.
And let's go ahead and learn more about USA football right now.
We believe in football. We believe in Friday night lights, Saturday afternoons, any given Sunday. And we believe in where all of that began. We believe heroes are made in the fourth quarter, and that every kickoff is a fresh start. We believe in pregame rituals and halftime speeches. We believe the best 11 will always beat the 11 best. We believe in teaching fundamentals and building character. We believe in educated coaches and engaged parents. We believe in creating a positive experience for all and in keeping the game fun. We believe in team. We believe in the lineage of Bryant, Rockney, Lombardi, and Dad. We believe you don't need a stadium or yard lines to have a game. We believe that even greater than the heroes on the big screen are those you give a ride to home from the game. We believe there is nothing more American than football, and that football gives us all something to believe in. Teamwork. Confidence. Pride. We are USA Football. We believe the scoreboard doesn't tell the whole story. We believe in the football family and that we can achieve a better, safer game together. We believe in football.
This matchup today brought to you by Sports Authority, the official sporting goods provider of USA Football. Also brought to you by Riddell, the official helmet and protective equipment partner of USA Football. And, of course, today's game, again, so many good things to watch in this contest. And, again, what are some things you're excited about today, Emory?
You look at the offensive line. You want to see how good offensive line play is in any All-Star game. And seeing how these guys were coached yesterday, the different techniques they were taught, I'm very excited to see those guys get out there and compete in a live game.
Yeah, you were here for the practices. And, again, it did seem, I'm sure, a lot of intensity in these practices because it's a lot of the best, correct?
And it's a lot of competition. I mean, you not only do you want to win for your football team, you want to be the best out there. When you see guys in these All-Star settings being the better player and trying to raise their level of play compared to the other guys, you have to be excited about that.
Yeah, and again, we're really excited to bring you this matchup today. So many good players out there. And again, just what I think the theme that runs through this entire thing, Emory, is besides the USA Football element of it, these kids just love to compete and play on the gridiron.
Exactly. You're playing football in the summertime. And remember back when we were out there, you didn't want to do anything in the summer. These guys are out here playing football, so they really have to love it. And it's a good thing to see.
Yeah, and really, again, a wonderful matchup today on a wonderful venue, this Towson University Stadium, just a United Stadium here at Towson, a wonderful venue, and these kids, I'm sure, are very happy to play. We talked about some of the captains earlier. We'll refresh them for you. All four of the white team, again, coached by head coach Chris Merritt, and number 9, Ben Tauber, also number 22, Brandon White, number 52, Eric DeMeo, and number 63, Michael Krajewski. And then on the other side of things, for the red team, coach by Danny Cowgill, Mike Golick, also number 20, Terrell Lindsay, number 74, Brian Bond, and number 93, Riley Holland. So captains at the middle of the field. Again, as you see, the white team wearing all white today, the red team wearing all red, and, of course, sharing that USA Football helmet. The white team will receive, and they'll go ahead and start on offense. And some interesting rules when it comes to the start of the game, Emory, where really the special teams not exactly live.
Exactly, and you don't want to get too football-y, so to speak, in these type of games because it's really all about technique. And if you are not able to practice special teams in which live contact is involved, you just want to keep it simple to where guys can just execute and be at their best.
And we'll see the kickoff here. We'll see the kickers go through everything and kick it. We'll see where we'll have return men catching the ball, and then after that should be a dead ball, and we'll see where they spot it afterwards. But again, but as you said, that's important because one of the first notes we got from the folks, this is a development program, and actually they're going to start on offense. Excuse me, they will not go with the kickoff. So we'll do punts though. Those will be live in this kind. They will not be live. They will be, as we said, kind of pseudo live, if you will, where the punter will go through all the steps, will do everything, and they'll catch it, and that will be the spot of the ball right there. So almost ready to get this one underway here from Towson. Glad you could join us here at the U.S. Development Games. Starting quarterback for the white team today, starting will be Ben Tauber out of Glastonbury, Connecticut. He'll have three wide receivers and a back next to him. Going to hand off up the middle and not much gain there. Justin Prim will be brought down by the big front of the red team.
Yeah, you look at the defensive lineman, Brian Bond was in on that tackle from Upper Montclair, New Jersey, a Jersey kid. But that's the one thing I was interested to see was how well this offensive line and defensive line get out there and get after one another.
Yeah, Bond, again, good size, class of 2017, so he'll have two more years left at the high school level. In this game, a lot of your guys here, the 2018s, the 2017s, so some guys who will have some more years in this USA Football program.
And it's good to have those guys out there getting this getting repetition against top talent across the country.
Again, three wide receiver set for Coach Merritt's squad. Tauber looking over the defense. And now he'll scramble, get away outside, looking for someone, just going to throw that one away. I think maybe thinking, make sure only my guy can get it if he can.
And a good part about these all-star games, during the practices, you're not allowed to hit the quarterback, right? So you want to see how these quarterbacks are going to function in a live game when they're actually going to get hit. And now these guys are going to have to – the defensive players are going to have to make sure they wrap up and not just tag the guy. That could have been a sack right there, but I'm pretty sure he's going to get those kinks worked out as the game starts to roll because he's still in practice mode right now.
You see Jip Bond again putting some pressure on there in the backfield. So looking at a third down here for the White squad as they'll go ahead and look to convert on the first down. And they have a third and long situation here. They'll send two receivers up top. Johnson will be joined by Rashawn Bray out of Columbus, Georgia, and two receivers to the bottom as well. Dauber going to throw it out in the flat. That one incomplete as he looked for Rashawn Bray. Couldn't connect, and the white team likely going to send on the punting unit.
Yeah, Rashawn Bray is a big kid. That's a big guy out there, wide receiver. They went with a single high look, man coverage, and they kind of dictated where they had where the white team wanted to go with the football.
So now on to do the kicking. Bentley Faulkner out of Greensboro, Grimsley High School, plays soccer, as a lot of the kickers do. And you see kind of modified where they'll send a few guys back like you might see at the lower levels of youth football trying to make sure that there's no bounce and no roll. A little miscommunication there as two players for the Red Squad don't really go after the ball. Terrell Lindsay and Zachary Thomas kind of, I got it, you take it, gave some extra yardage up.
And that was a really good punt. Really got a good turnover, and it actually – tilted it toward the left sideline, which was excellent.
So just a few minutes gone here in our matchup between Team Merritt and Team Calgill. And the opening possession for the White squad doesn't get much. So now the Red squad will go ahead and send their team out. Leading them out today will be Gerald Filardi, young quarterback out of Dix Hills, New York, Half Hollow Hills West High School. And as we mentioned in the open, his father, Gerald, also named Gerald, played at Penn State, a linebacker under Joe Paterno. Pistol set here with a wing. Filardi going to pitch it out, looking for some running room and getting a little bit. Be Mike Golick out of Jackson, New Jersey, gain of about 3 on the play.
And you've been hearing his name a lot all week long. Excellent player for Team White.
And if you want to go ahead and follow us on Twitter or Facebook, you see him on the screen at usnft.com. Twitter and Instagram both can go ahead and let you know what you're thinking about this game. Any pictures you want to share, do it with those two. Again, USNFT. So a 2nd and 8, we'll call it. Need to take the ball out to the 39-yard line for a first down. Filardi drops the snap for a second. Now get it out in the flat and hit Bilodeau, who will take it for about 5 yards. And Bilodeau, a guy really these coaches really like.
And the tight end position has been one of, you know, great asset here. They really love all the tight ends in this week of practice. So I'm excited to see how both teams play. Nice little turn route right there. Catch the ball, get upfield. Simple football play, but effective.
Bilodeau, one of the three or four guys who are playing for Woodbury Forest. Of course, their coach, Clint Alexander, will be coaching in the second game here. But Bilodeau, a guy, really exciting talent out of Virginia that a lot of folks are looking forward to doing some big things. So the red team looking at a 3rd and 3, and then you get it to the 39 for a first down. Slant pattern is going to have first down yardage out to the 45-yard line. Jaden Brunson going to make the catch to go ahead and move the sticks.
And that was a great play, great throw by Filardi. You see right there, the job against man coverage, you want to hold it, then release. Wait till that guy crosses the face of the corner, then you want to fire it in there, right where he had to catch it to where he can keep running and was able to pick up the first down.
So Filardi able to move the sticks, and the red team will go ahead after the white squad couldn't get a first down on their opening possession. The red team does, and running down upon 8:52 to go here in the quarter. Filardi going to hand off up the middle and some running room and near first down yardage for Mike Golick.
Mike Gallett refused to be denied on that one. That's how you want to hit the hole, explode through the hole, and was able to keep those legs churning and pick up a big game.
Gallick, a guy who's put up some impressive stats in his career as we check out this replay, Emery.
Straight down at A-gap, midline option right there. Feet churning and was able to fight for a couple extra yards, eight yards on a first down.
And you said it a little bit in talking to these about these backs, not the biggest complement of backs, but a lot of guys who can do a lot of good things.
Yeah, you want to get guys that are quick, that can get downhill pretty fast. They've done a great job all week practicing.
Flaherty in the pistol, again going to hand off to Golic up the middle, and he'll have first down yardage. So a second straight first down for the Red Squad as they're starting to move the sticks.
And you're starting to see why I was so excited about the offensive line, defensive line play. Red Team's offensive line is doing an excellent job firing off the football.
We talk about Golic, and some of the stats that he's put up are just amazing. In his eighth grade year, Emery, he ran for 2,254 yards and 37 touchdowns.
I don't think I've taken 2,000 steps in eighth grade, but that's amazing right there.
And a timeout going to be called. A little bit of miscommunication on the offensive end for Coach Calgill's squad, so they'll go ahead and huddle it up, as will the white team. And I think if you're in the white team huddle right now, you're trying to, again, it's a development game, but these guys are playing hard. And again, it is a matchup that you'd like to see you guys maybe play a little tougher defense. Of course, the alumni in this one, it's a who's who when you really get down to it. You look at some of the guys, Todd Gurley, Jameis Winston, two high draft picks this year, both in the first round. Jameis going number one overall, but a lot of guys, and again, younger guys as well, because USA football just kind of starting to churn out the guys that are making to the pros, but some very good names there, Emery.
I mean, you look at Ty Montgomery of the Green Bay Packers, excellent receiver. Tyrann Mathieu of the Arizona Cardinals. Stephon Tuitt, all these guys are premier talented guys that have taken the time to come to USA football and have honed their skills.
And then you got some guys who will be pros at one point. Samaje Perine of Oklahoma, of course, has the record. We're talking about rushing records. He has the rushing record for a game in NCAA history at Division I, but a lot of good names on that as well. Kevin Hogan, the quarterback for Stanford, also a USA football alumni. So first and 10 for the Red Squad on the white side of the field. And Flaherty will miscommunicate on the handoff, and he will get brought down hard. Looking in the backfield, was trying to go again with that read option and just did not communicate it with the running back, Kyle Wright, went the wrong way and had a problem.
And that's one, as a quarterback, you just have to eat it and get upfield. And first time on the defensive side, we saw a little soft zone coverage as well. And, again, quarterback miscommunication, just have to eat that one and get upfield.
Again, playing with the High School Federation rules, so 12-minute quarters for them. And again, you know, get to college, you start playing the 15 minutes, but this will be 12. And, of course, these guys looking to maybe get to college at some point in their career. The pistol formation again. Red's gone with that exclusively. Now it gets hit in the back as Flaherty was getting ready to throw. And, again, I think a miscommunication there as it appeared that the running back right just kind of ran up his back.
Yeah, technique is everything. And, you know, they teach you steps for a reason. Everything is all about timing with the passing game. And if you're a little bit off in any facet of it, this could happen, and that's exactly what happened. Maybe the running back was thinking one play, and the quarterback was thinking another.
And again, you're going to see that these guys have only been together here at this venue for just this week. Got in, I believe, on Sunday, and have been here since practicing, but only so much time you can get in 1 week's time, correct?
Exactly, and you can't, you know, beat these guys up against the head too hard because, again, it's not an all-star game, but a developmental game where they have to, you know, they don't have the timing down pat yet.
So looking at 3rd and 14, so Flaherty going to have to throw it deep to get the first down. Almost completes it as threw it a little bit low, and Gregory got bumped on his route but couldn't make the catch. Had a shot at it, though.
Yeah, you want to see him get down a little bit lower to try to scoop that ball up, and Flaherty had to wait for him to cross face. And, again, could have been a big play, but you also have to give credit to the defense because he did his job and made that throw tough.
So Faulkner on to punt. And again, switching the punters up here because Faulkner did the kicking duties for the white squad as well. Believe we'll also see Faulkner's going to do the punting, looks like, for both squads. No kicker listed for the red team. So again, him getting some good reps. And Faulkner's kick this time, not as good. And the white squad, again, letting it get by. It eventually will be fielded by Felix McCorkle. So they'll have the ball just outside, just inside the 20-yard line.
You want to see who comes out on the second drive, establishes themselves, and now that the game, the first, what, half of the quarter jitters are over, these guys can come out, settle down, play some good, efficient football.
Yeah, and again, I'm sure Coach Merritt would love to see his team get a little momentum going after that opening drive where it went three and out, while the red team actually got a couple things going there. White team going to stay with Tauber under center. Of course, we'll see all these guys get some time throughout the game. Well worth it after their week of good play. That handoff going to be stuffed off tackle for not a lot as Speltz, Jonathan Speltz of Rochester, New Hampshire, going to be brought down for a minimal gain.
Defensive line is doing a great job resetting the line of scrimmage. I tell you right now, that defensive line of the red team is playing some outstanding football. Great ball get off. The defensive end set the edge, created the lane for the backer to come up and make the play.
Seeing these guys up front for that red squad really getting in the back foot, as you said, and kind of playing on the other end. I believe Vincent Woodard of Accokeek, Maryland, the guy kind of getting that penetration up the field. A lot of folks in this game, mostly from up and down the Eastern Seaboard, though we do have some outliers. Have a couple guys playing in one of the three games today from Oregon, a couple from California, and you believe a few from Texas as well, but a lot of New Jersey, a lot of Virginia, a lot of Maryland you're going to see in this contest, also some of the New England states. Now scrambling for his life and getting loose and maybe getting a positive gain, actually can get some good yardage out of this and brought down just short of the sticks as Tauber running for his life at one point, then made something out of nothing.
Listen, and that was a great job showing, you know, good understanding of where everybody was on the field, because he really navigated his way, set up the blocking almost like a punt return, and was able to pick up a big game. You see right here, he's slow playing it, coming across. Oh, that's a play before, but that was a great play by the defensive line, like we mentioned. But the quarterback, again, set up the blocking, came back across the field, and was able to pick up nearly a first down.
Yeah, it's funny. I was watching, I believe, a special on the greatest Pittsburgh Steelers on the NFL Network, and they showed, of course, the Troy Polamalu punt return against the interception return against the Ravens, where he did exactly that. Just kind of weaved his way through the team, and Tauber looked a little like Polamalu there without the hair. Tauber going to take it on the read option up the field. He'll have first down yardage and a little bit more out to the 35-yard line. So Tauber using his feet instead of his arm to get the first.
And Tauber showing a little bit of moxie running the football, putting that shoulder down and getting that first down. Again, he had a lot of success. This is the play before we talked about. Just slow played it. That's a guy that understands his athleticism and knows that he can make that play and was able to do a great job two plays ago.
Yeah, Brian Bond saying that's not fair. Had him kind of in the backfield. But again, good job by Bond. You see him on our replay. He was right there to make that tackle if Tauber cut back. Again, we talked about this in the pregame. A lot of effort. These guys all love playing football. You're not going to see a lot of guys taking plays off. Tauber back to throw. Going to throw that one out and incomplete as reaching high for it and not be able to bring it in. Asher Titus as the pass was broken up by the corner.
Great coverage out there on the flanks by the cornerback. Did a great job keeping that receiver in that five-yard area. Good bump. Had rolled his outside shoulder. That's a great play by the defensive back. That's how you coach it up.
Mark White, local guy out of Baltimore, Maryland, on that coverage. White out of Archbishop Curley. One of the, obviously in the D.C. area and the Baltimore area, some very good private Catholic high schools, and that's one of them. Second and 10 for Coach Merritt's white squad, and see some procedure here, and we'll see our first flag of the ball game. Let's see who it goes on.
Looks like he switched up that count, drew the guys offside.
Referee going to say offsides on the red squad, so a free 5 yards for the white team, and that's going to help them out and keep this drive going that's got a little bit of momentum.
You look at the defense of the red squad, very aggressive. We've seen tight man coverage. We've seen the defensive line fire off the football. You want to see on the other side, will they start to throw your screens and maybe throw a draw in there at some point to try to neutralize this rush.
Second and 5, need to get it out to the 45-yard line for a first down. 3 wide receiver set, back in the backfield, handoff, trying to pick his way through and not finding a lot of success as Speltz as he'll be brought down for a 1-yard gain.
Brian Bond is definitely making it himself known today early on this ball game by chasing down a quarterback, stonewalling guys at the line of scrimmage. You see right here, maintaining the line of scrimmage, being able to disrupt and make that play. That's a great job by Bond.
And it's funny, in some of our pregame things, you were kind of talking about guys at this level, you can tell they're good when they can kind of discard with their hands. Bond did a great job right there.
Excellent technique right there. Again, this game is about technique, and he's showing all of the levels that you want to see from a defensive lineman.
Again, Bond out of Montclair High School in Upper Montclair, New Jersey. Fake the handoff, keep on the read option, some room to run, and diving for the first down will be Tauber, and he should have it.
Tauber gave the defender a little dead leg right there, be able to make a miss and dive forward for the first down. You see right here on the replay, give him a little hesitation, a little Antoine Walker from the Celtics, dive forward for a first down.
Tauber out of Glastonbury, Connecticut, goes to Kingswood Oxford School. See, as we said, a lot of guys up and down the Eastern Seaboard playing this game. Also some Florida guys, some Georgia guys as well. So you can almost call this the I-95 Classic if you want, because the guys just kind of get on down and get down here or get up depending on which way they were coming from. Four wide receivers for Tauber, looking it over on a first down. He'll go back to throw, trying to set up a screen. That one's going to be incomplete as he was looking to get it out to Rashawn Bray out in the flat. And again, another good play by the defensive backs of the Red Squad.
And you saw right there, that was a combination of, okay, we have to beat the pressure with a quick play, a screen. But again, the pressure of the Red Squad has been able to disrupt everything Team White wants to do. A lot of the big plays that come from Team White have come from Tauber running the football.
Yeah, Tauber really has gotten the job done with the legs. The passing game almost been non-existent here, really, for the White squad with coming up on our end of the first quarter here as we look in this one. And, again, we see both teams on the same side of the field, interestingly. Again, we'll see all these guys are practicing together, so shouldn't see any issues with that. But, again, just kind of maybe an interesting look for you as you see it on your screen. The four-wide set here. Tauber again back to throw. Again goes over the middle and again has trouble hooking up with Bray as that one a little bit right in front of him just couldn't hang on.
And playing aggressive defense is all about attitude. And you see the great attitude that the red team is playing with. They're flying around the football. They're in the faces of the receivers. Linebackers are doing their job versus the run. D-line is firing off the football. And as you see here, look how quickly they close in on the receiver. Had he caught the football, it would have been a stop right there for a minimal gain. So this team has been playing great defensively, great team defense all around by the Red Squad.
See, that was Matthew Corton coming up and going to have another timeout. So teams will think this one over. Again, here at Towson University, just outside of Baltimore, Maryland, at Johnny United Stadium. Yes, it's named after the former Baltimore Colts quarterback. Again, a legend in these parts. And Towson, a program that really has done some very good things at the FCS level over the last few years. And, again, these facilities are just a wonderful place to call a game like we're doing or come out and watch one. And I guess I'm sure these kids really liking what they've been able to experience here at Towson this week.
Yeah, I took a stroll through the campus yesterday. I was amazed how, you know, well put together this campus is and this football facility. And what they've done over the course of the last 5 years with this program has been outstanding. We talked about it earlier, about how they went from a D3 school up to now the FCS level and being a really good FCS football team.
And believe the runners-up at FCS 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. So really they've, again, have got themselves going. And, again, an area that has so much talent, if you can mind it, you can always have a good football team. Tauber, again, talking about some talent, showed off his wares so far in this game, looking for the swing pass, and he's got something, got a big gain. Flag's going to go down. If the play holds up, the completion to Justin Prim should give the white team a first down, but let's see what the flag is.
Great play call versus pressure. You want to isolate the one-on-one matchups. Backs versus linebackers is a matchup that the running back should win every time. Speaking as a former running back, he should win that every time. He was wide open, caught the football, but that was a great stop by the defensive back to stop for a minimal game, or for a big game, stopping him in his tracks.
I'm going to say offensive pass interference, so I'm assuming.
Looks like a pick by number 6 was able to pick off that corner. That's Johnson, I believe. Kind of held a block there, which is why the guy couldn't get over there. But,
and, of course, that kind of came to prominence last year, that game Notre Dame and Florida State, where Notre Dame mm-hmm. on the goal line got called for the pick. And, you know, there's an art to that play. Usually, as I – and my – obviously, you got a little more football coaching experience than I do, but I always – you try and tell the kids, just make it like basketball. Just get in their way. It's not the full-on hit.
Right. And if you're gonna hit them, just play like you were running your route. Just try to run through them and keep – get up and keep running. But – don't stop and block the guy.
That's going to move it all the way back to the 30-yard line, so they need to take it down to the 45 of the Red Squad for a first down. Tough task for Tauber as goes back out of the shotgun, going to throw it deep, and this one almost picked off. Could have been, it looked like, but just sailing over the head of defensive back McKay Self, so he just lets it go over. If he had a chance at it, probably better off to go let it go, and again, it'll be a punting time for the White Squad.
Yeah, you have to ask the receiver to run through that route. You want to be able to continue to run because you see Tauber is waiting, and the receiver kind of rounded off, didn't think he was getting the football, and slowed down. That's why you see the overthrow. You want to run through that route and be able to make a play on it.
I believe he's looking for Asher Titus on that one. So, again, on to punt. Been doing the punting and kicking duties for both sides. Bentley Faulkner out of Greensboro. The Grimsley High School product with a nice kick here. This one, again, going to bounce, then takes a left turn, and it'll be stopped at about the 35-yard line right there by number 27, McKay Self. So that's where the red team will scrimmage from with just about 90 seconds to go in the quarter.
Both kicker and punters for both teams were working on some cool things yesterday at practice, trying to hit the light pole from an angle. So working on direction, working on accuracy. And that's why you see a lot of these kicks going, you know, left or right sideline, which is great.
And you always wonder with those kickers, you know, you sit there, if you played any position in football besides kicker, you always wonder, what are those guys doing over there? They're not really doing the same stuff we are. But, again, so important to have a good kicker. We've seen it so many times where at every level, if you don't have that good kicker, it really is going to come back and bite you at some point. New quarterback into the game, handoff up the middle, and some room to run, and maybe a lot of room to run as breaking in, cutting it all the way back, and finally brought down at the 30-yard line, Mike Golick, taking the handoff by the new quarterback in, Jared Wagenhofer, and taking it a long way.
You're not going to stop Golick, you can see now, with one with an arm tackle.
35-yard gain by Golick. Check out the replay right here.
See right here, straight midline action, exploding through the hole. One tackle, two tackles. You know, breaking tackles, three. As a running back, that's what you want to see. What can you do after you get past the line of scrimmage? Your eyes will get you past the line of scrimmage. Your skill set will take you wherever you want to go after that.
Golick had 21 touchdowns for his school last year. That is a school record. Again, a miscommunication on the option. And Wagenhofer just going to try and get what he can get, getting all the way to the outside. Let's go ahead and get it down to the sidelines for the first time with our Jack Feely.
Hey, guys, thanks very much. You know, one of the advantages we have of being down here on the sideline is that we get to see these players up close and personal and really get a sense of what they are like on the football field. And one of those players we want to highlight is number 48 on Team Calgo, Kyle Belodu, a 6'3", 216-pound sophomore tight end out of Woodbury Forest School down there in the middle of Virginia. And he's been credited since the sixth grade as really the next big thing coming out of Virginia in a while. I got a chance to speak with his father earlier this week, and he's been with USA Football for the last 3 years. In fact, he's played in the last two international bowls. And I asked him what he's like off the field, aside from on the field, and he said he's just a giant teddy bear who always puts the team first, but he's always trying to hone his craft whenever he's on the football field. I asked his father, what's the one thing that Kyle needs to work on as he progresses throughout high school? He says that's his speed. As you know, a tight end, he's rather big and burly, but he needs to increase his speed, especially off of the line. And one of the other things that he told me that most people may not know about him is that he can sing and act as well, and that if football never turns out, he might turn to the stage. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Jack. And holding on the play, that's going to move it back, and we'll see if the red team will go ahead and run one more play. Looks like they're going to try to.
Great alley defense right there by Team White, getting out there. Even though, despite the penalty, we're able to get to the alley and shut down that outside run.
It's going to move it back 10, and they'll mark it down back at the 41-yard line. So red team will scrimmage from there on a second down. And they'll run it till they snap. Again, Wagenhofer into the game out of Dover, Delaware. Goes to Caesar Rodney High School. Shifting up front by the white team defensive line. They'll pitch it out. Pulling up, looking like he's going to throw. Golick's going to go ahead and pull it down and take off. And big block. And Golick getting to the outside. And he may get in. Going to be hit and still on his feet, and Golic brought down just short of the end zone at the four-yard line. What a run by Mike Golic. That's going to bring us to the end of the first quarter. A flag down on the play, though, and let's see what that's going to be. We'll go ahead and find out more about that flag when we come back right after this. They'll wave it off. We'll take a quick break. No score here at Towson.
No one ever talks about the second quarter. It doesn't get a Nike commercial or a pregame speech. No one writes it on their wrist or on their shoe. There's no falling confetti, no kissing trophies, no breaks or halftime adjustments. Yet, it's the second quarter where you find your rhythm, your tempo, and the schemes that work. It's where you need determination to keep on grinding towards your goal, where you face adversity and rise above, where what matters isn't your critics, but the encouragement of your teammates and the words spoken by your coach. The second quarter is where you keep momentum after a fast start, where each person must continue to do his job every play, every down. It's where steadfast belief in your goal is paramount. Heads Up Football has started fast. 123,000 coaches have been certified. 60% of the game participates. But you don't change the culture of football overnight. It's now the second quarter. So with the ball in your hands, I ask you a simple question. What can we do next?
Welcome back to Towson University. No score here in our USA development game between Coach Chris Merrill's squad and Coach Danny Calgill's squad, the red and the white. This contest brought to you by St. Vincent Sports Performance. Of course, St. Vincent Sports Performance, the official sports medicine partner of the U.S. national team. Also, the game brought to you by Just Play Solutions. So Mike Golic getting his team down into scoring position.
That was a heck of a run, by the way.
So shotgun here for Wagenhofer. Seen the red squad in pretty much the whole game in shotgun. Golic going to get the handoff and will be brought down in the backfield and shooting the gap and getting back there. Eric DeMaio, big play by him.
And again, as you get closer to the end zone, the field starts to shrink. And this is where you're going to have to try to, you know, get those guys out of what they're in. So you want to see a little bit more passing. If you're going to run the football, you want to see a little bit more power. But that was just a great play by the defensive line. We're going to go back to the other play. It looks like it was going to be a trick play. They worked on this all week long. But Golic just decided, you know what? I didn't like what I see, like what I saw. I'm going to take it to, you know, almost down to the end zone.
And I tell you, if I'm a coach, I really like that because you see so many times the running back, they go out there no matter what, they're throwing the ball.
Mm-hmm.
It's an option. You know, that's one thing that when Vince Lombardi ran it, used to run back in the day, it's an option. You can run it or you can pass it. And Golic didn't like his option for the throw, so he decided to go ahead and run it. Wagenhofer looking for the slants. Got it. Touchdown, red team. Actually, ball comes loose. They're going to say incomplete pass. Interesting call there, as it looked like getting close to the end zone and maybe getting in was number 18, Jaden Brunson, but then they say the ball got knocked loose on his way into the end zone.
And that was a great pass by Wagenhofer, going in, throwing the football exactly where it had to be. Receiver has to make that play. Tried to do a little bit extra. Almost looked like he got in, but a great play by the defensive back, not giving up on it.
Yeah, maybe. Looked like he did take one or two steps after he caught that ball, so we'll see. But again, third and goal here, so give the red team another chance to see what they can do. And again, play a little slow coming in. Wagenhofer going to go ahead and hurry and try and keep the pace going. No, not running with a play clock here, as you can maybe catch on one of our shots. Actually, you can see it over the white team's shoulder there. 25-second play clock they use at Towson in the collegiate game, but they're not using it here. Wagenhofer in the shotgun. He's got a stand-up tight end and three wide receivers looking over the middle, and now he has a touchdown again, getting to the guy we saw earlier in the game, Kyle Bilodeau out of Mechanicsville, Virginia. He scores and takes it in, and the red team breaks the ice.
Two things you notice. One, the tight end play, like we talked about, has been outstanding, and what a great throw again by Wagenhofer. The placement on this pass you're going to see on the replay, it was right where the tight end could only get it. The defensive back would have to have gone through the receiver. He tried to do that, but that was a great throw and a great catch. Perfect for the touchdown.
Bilodeau down on the field, so they'll be treating him. And he looked at first like it might just be a cramp, tried to kind of stretch it out. So, again, he's one of the really – you talked about tight ends, good ones in this game. Well, if you look at it, another guy we're going to see a little bit later, John Kervin, a tight end for Woodbury Forest. And we're going to see Bilodeau headed to Woodbury Forest as well. So they're going to have a stockade of tight ends. So those guys are very good players.
And the funny part is that this is a situation where we've seen the tight end almost go by the wayside in football. And to see a game that has excellent tight ends, or we're going to see multiple games with excellent tight ends, it's promising for the position. And guys that can do both, block and catch.
And, you know, it's one of those things where I think you have to kind of look at it and say to yourself, hey, you know, we see it, and we see teams running certain offenses, and you would have to think that teams built to stop one thing can't stop another. So you would think that so many teams running spread, if you have some good tight ends, it's going to be a tough matchup for anybody you see.
And if I'm looking at the position itself, I want a bigger guy, that quote-unquote extra offensive lineman, that athletic offensive lineman that can also catch the football if need be. And if I'm a college coach right now, I'm tuned into this game. Why? Because there's some excellent tight ends, and we know how valuable they are over the middle of the field.
Bilodeau still be being looked at by the trainers. He's on his feet. And again, at this point, if you're Bentley Faulkner, this is good practice for him. It's almost like they're icing him. He's kind of having to wait to go ahead and take his kick here.
And they drew the best game because they are playing at 9 o'clock in the morning East Coast time. And so the 1 o'clock game, they're going to have to deal with the heat. So great job by whoever pulled this game for these guys to play early.
Bilodeau going to go off with a little bit of help, so we hope he's all right. Again, it's so close to the high school season for these guys. You don't want to see anybody come up injured. Again, as these guys that love playing for USA football, but also love that passion for playing for their high school team as well. So, again, won't see a rush here, but the snap will be live, and they'll go ahead and get the timing down and getting it one down, a little bit of a low snap. But Faulkner going to put it through, and that will be a extra point. So now 7-0, the white squad on top of the red squad on top of the white squad here at Towson. Now let's go ahead and get it down to the field again with our Jack Feely.
Jeremy Emery, thanks so much. You know, we noted at the beginning of the broadcast that first and foremost, this is a developmental program. Most of the kids playing here today, a few of them are going to be selected and move on to Texas to play in the International Bowl in January of next year. And that really answers the question as to why these kids come out, because if they are not really on the radar of any college coaches or going on beyond that, this game can really put them on that radar, including some of the alumni that I'm about to read off, including the newly drafted Todd Gurley, the running back for the St. Louis Rams, Jameis Winston, the number one overall pick this past year in the NFL draft. And another name to include in that group is Kevin Hogan, the current Stanford quarterback, who's actually a local product out of Gonzaga College High School here in the district. And last one is Samaje Perine. And if that name sounds familiar, it's because he now holds the FBS record for most yards rushed in a game when he did it last November against Kansas for Oklahoma, 427 to be exact. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Jack. Yes, Maje with a fantastic game and, again, fantastic season. It's funny, Emery, you kind of look at Samaje Perine, the fact that, you know, they did that documentary on Marcus Dupree, the greatest ever was, in one of the 30 for 30s. And I tell you, I bet a lot of Oklahoma fans kind of see the same thing when you talk about the immense size and speed to get by people.
I was doing some scouting work with him earlier in the summer and just came away blown away with how well he runs the football. Great vision for a tailback.
So Weston Cook now into the game. He'll go ahead and pitch out on the option, trying to get to the outside, and a little bit of room to run there, and nice gain there for number 25, Brennan Richardson out of West Creek, New Jersey. That's going to get it up, and I believe going to be a first down.
That's a great individual effort by Richardson, because what you want to see on that option play is a quarterback attack downhill to try to force that defensive player, that end man on the line of scrimmage, to commit and pull on him so he can pitch it. That was an early pitch, but Richardson did a great job making one guy miss in the open field and picking up positive yards.
So again, Weston Cook on for Ben Tauber at the first two series for the White Squad. Get midway, close to the midway point of the second quarter here at Towson. Cook, throw across the middle. That one's going to be incomplete, looking to hook up with Cameron Wicks.
And that was a good throw by Cook. I mean, when you look at what he did, throwing a quick slant over the wide side of the field, you want to put the right placement on the football. It hit the receiver right in the stomach, and that's a play that the receiver has to make, but the great throw by the quarterback.
Thank some of our fine sponsors for this contest. Flip Give, Gatorade, Sports Authority, Rydell, and Volt Athletic, all wonderful, wonderful supporters of USA football. So a second and 10 here. Need to take it out across the 46-yard line for a first down. Weston Cook, the quarterback out of Mint Hill, North Carolina. Graduate, part of the class of 2018, and some procedure up front. Let's see who this one goes on. Official slow on his signals today. It will be a false start, so that's going to move it back to the 31-yard line, setting up the first and 15.
And we're up in the booth, but you can still hear the coaches saying, watch the ball on the opposite side of the field. So point of emphasis for this football team, got to be disciplined if you want to be able to get off the field.
It's one of those things you see a lot with those good defensive lines. They can get off the ball, but they don't jump off sides and give up those free yards. It's a delicate balance, if you will, for guys who are pretty big, of getting off that ball quickly, but then also being able to do it and not give up the penalty yardage to the other team's offense. Four wide receivers. Back to throw, getting hit and brought down, and a flag will go down, and I guess they're going to call a face mask on that one as Cook brought down. Looked like got him by the jersey as two players for the Red Squad met back there at Cook, but I think they may catch a break on this one.
Yeah, Vincent Woodard came unblocked and really stonewalled the quarterback. Strong hands right there to pull him down. I wonder if he got a face mask maybe.
I think the hand that we saw up here, the left hand was okay on the jersey, but I think the right hand able to go ahead and got on the face mask. So Woodard with a good job to get back there, but couldn't do it. So that's going to be a personal foul, and that's going to give the white team a first down, or at least it should.
And I would expect we're going to hear the coaches again on the opposite side screaming. But, hey, you got a big play like that, a sack like that, an opportunity to get off the field. You can't beat yourself with those penalties.
Woodard out of Accokeek, Maryland, goes to Gwynn Park High School, one of the smaller Maryland powers, but also his cousin Reggie Barnes played in the CFL, so he's hoping to follow him into the pros someday and, again, maybe be open to Canada. You got to be open anywhere. They're going to let you play football and get money for it. Pass
exactly.
Over the middle. That one's incomplete. The slant pattern intended for Ryan Rougeau out of Old Bridge, New Jersey, couldn't hook up with him.
And you see what the red team is doing defensively. They're playing press on the outside. They're playing tight man coverage on the outside. They're bracketing the inside receiver. So they're going to combo cover him with the backer and the slot guy. And they do a great job of squeezing that space, getting there, making that a tough window for the quarterback. And that's how they're able to force an incomplete pass.
Sean Johnson on the coverage. Johnson, a product of Linden, New Jersey. As we said, a lot of guys from New Jersey in this game. Just a quick hop down. That's where you made your hop down from, correct?
Correctly. A three-hour drive. Not bad at all.
Four wides on this third and long. And sack. And this one's going to count. And, again, it's the guy we've been eyeing up the entire game, Emery, Brian Bond, with another big play.
Bond is well on his way to getting player of the game because Bond has been a disruptive force throughout the course of the early part of this game. But you see right there, the quarterback, he saw something late. He saw this guy coming across. He saw the open receiver in the slot, wanted to go to him as he came to his third option. But as we know, you have to get rid of that football. You only have so many seconds in the pocket before you're going to get pressure, and that's what happened. He took a sack.
And Cook kind of laid there for a little bit, may have gone down on his shoulder, and it looked almost like his offensive linemen were waving at the sidelines, come check him out. But to his credit, tough kid, he got right back up and got off the field. And again, Brian Bond, a lot of big weight coming down right there again. But we saw the technique, though, there. Again, we talked about his hands. Really impressed with that as he was able to just discard that offensive tackle there and get to the quarterback.
Yeah, he's a guy that's a junior coming up this year, which is outstanding play. And up at Montclair, that's around my area, I'm definitely going to have to go check him out during this football season.
Yeah, if he plays like this, he's going to be a fun one to watch. Again, Faulkner kicking for both teams. This one, a pretty good one. He's going to take it all the way out to the 35-yard line. It'll be caught there, and the red team will go ahead and scrimmage from there as they look to go ahead and add on to their 7-0 lead.
Great punt again. Again, nice turnover on the punt, and they're doing a great job with these directional punts, which is, again, something they worked on exclusively this week.
Let's look at our regional development camps for USA Football, brought to you by Sports Authority. Of course, Sports Authority, the official sporting good provider of USA Football. And you look at some of the areas there, and these were the smaller camps that kind of fed into these development games. But again, a lot of areas for these guys to go ahead and show their skills.
Exactly. You see a lot of in Texas. You see some schools, some places out there in California. You go to East Coast and Washington, D.C., and Charlotte, North Carolina.
Again, Sports Authority, the official sporting goods partner, provider, of USA Football. Had a minimal gain there for the Red Squad.
And here's the thing. You know, people talk about option quarterbacks and they talk about reading defenses. That was one element of being able to read the defense. That was a great decision by the QB, given the football. He saw the end man on the line of scrimmage crashing down. Give the football. Don't pull it. Don't take a hit. And allow the running back to pick up yards. Minimal gain, but a great decision nonetheless.
Gerald Filardi back into the game. He started the contest with the first two series, so it appears to be the rotation we're going to see. Is two series. This one going to be a quick screen out and a little bit of yardage there, and eventually taking in a nice second effort to get it across the 40-yard line by the wide receiver Roger Holcomb, a local guy out of Baltimore, Maryland, goes to Towson High School.
And you want to see the receiver negotiate his way through traffic on that one. That was a great throw by the quarterback, throwing over the rush, which is tough to do on a screen like that. Those guys were in his face, and seeing him negotiate and try to get positive yards out of it.
Good job there by John Michael Ramos on the tackle, kind of weaved his way through the blockers, avoided them, and then ends up getting the stop there before the first down could be gained. So a third and four here. Need to get it out to the 45-yard line for a first down. Filardi joined in the backfield by Kyle Wright. He'll look to throw, looks to go deep. And this one's going to be caught! What a catch down the sidelines and hopping up after making a huge play. Mike Golick. Again, what can't he do, Emery?
I mean, you have to like the running back being able to catch the football like a receiver. That was almost Lynn Swan-esque in the Super Bowl versus Dallas. Great throw, by the way. That was a placement throw. The cornerback thought he was in great position to make that play, but you can't defend the perfect pass, and Golick made a great play on the football.
Yeah, that's our play of the game by Shock Doctor. The completion there by Gerald Filardi to Mike Golick. Again, a wonderful play. Again, our play of the game brought to you by Shock Doctor. Handoff up the middle. Going to be actually brought down for a loss, and we'll see it again. Just going deep.
In the slot right there. And, again, perfectly placed pass, great concentration, great grab, and great showmanship. You got to like that. That's the running back position for you.
Yeah, and that was one of the things. You look at a lot of these guys, and, of course, you're an old running back. You love when you see these guys do it. But a lot of these guys, good pass catchers out of the backfield as well. And if you're a college team or a high school, you got to love to see a guy like Golick be able to do both of those things that well.
Especially lined up in the slot and not out the traditional back set. He's lined up in the slot right now.
Filardi, pump fakes. That one incomplete, trying to go ahead and hook up with Jaden Brunson. Again, couldn't do it, so they'll be looking at a third and long here for the Red Squad.
Looks like we got a flag down as well.
Maybe a little early contact.
once again, look at the throw, look at the catch, concentration. The ball hit him at least 15 times before he was able to pull it in, but you'd like to see that concentration. Great grab, focusing on it, not worried about bodies around him, and coming up with the catch.
Charles Robinson and Felix McCorkle on the pretty good coverage there, right in his kitchen, but still able to bring it in. But that's going to be interference, so that's going to move it up. So a first down for the Red Squad up to the 13-yard line, so still can get a first down without scoring a touchdown, but again, really getting it moving. Now we're going to see the Red Squad look like they were going to go with an empty backfield. Instead, Gollick going to come back. He was going out to a slot receiver position. Instead, he'll be in the pistol. They'll pitch it out to him. Gollick trying to get to the corner, looking to cut it back. He'll be hit and brought down, but again, the forward lean going to get him a gain of four on the play.
He has good acceleration for a tailback and doesn't really make a lot of effort as far as changing direction is concerned. I really like the way he runs. He's another Jersey kid, and again, stockpiling my high school scouting thing. You know, I'm going to have to go and see him as well.
Looked like Emery there, just that good talent of knowing when to cut up and split that little bit of a gap that he had.
And it's more of weaving instead of cutting, which I like to see. Some guys are able to perfect that glide. Some guys have to make that hard cut. But this is an excellent running back right here, 14 Rhett.
So a second, we'll call it six. Pistol formation. To the game, slant pattern. This time it will be a touchdown, as getting in that time, Jaden Brunson thought he had one earlier. This time he does get one, and the Red Squad going up by two scores.
Well, I just pointed that out to you, and I was like, they're wide to the field. They set up the skinny post right there, and it was something you saw instantly from the snap. Great execution, great catch, and finished the play by the receiver for the touchdown.
Now a chance to make it a 14-point lead for the Red Squad. As Danny Calgill's got to be happy with his charges so far, as Faulkner, again, getting a chance to show off what he can do. And this one up, and Faulkner's kick will be good. So makes it a 14-0 game. Red Squad up on the White Squad, and expecting to see even games here. Right now, the Red Squad definitely kind of getting the better of this matchup.
Offensive line, defensive line. And you see right here, look at the top of the screen. As a corner, you have to understand the situation and where you are on the field. If the receiver comes all the way out to almost the bottom of the numbers to the hash, you know he's not going outside. You want to cheat in a little bit. That way you have the sideline as your friend. They told you they were running the slant right there, and that's a little bit of situational football you have to understand. He's going to get that as he gets older, but you saw that instantly from the snap.
And again, it'll be corrected over there on the sidelines. Again, these wonderful coaching staffs we have here use it as a teaching moment, I'm sure, to go ahead and make sure their guys get it. So the White Squad will have a chance at the two-minute offense here with 1:43 left to go in the half, as they'll look to get on the board, at least find a way to get some points going into the half.
Now we're starting to see these guys in soft coverage. When all throughout the game we saw Team Red press at the line of scrimmage, now we get to see the white team probably move the ball a little bit more effectively.
Ben Tauber back into the game. We saw Weston Cook go out on the last series after being sacked, brought down hard on his shoulder. So we'll see how much Tauber goes the rest of the way. He's in the shotgun, going to hand it off up the middle on the draw, and runs into a mess of tacklers from the Red Squad. So a gain of about three on the play.
You look at linebacker Richard Kardacki Jr. out of Mattawan, New Jersey, staying home, staying put, occupying that gap and making the play.
Justin Prim on the carry. 3-yard gain, and looks like the white team content to take their time here. Maybe they'll pick it up if they can get a first down. And Tauber in the shotgun. Prim alongside. Almost loses it. Now he's going to go ahead and keep it. Tauber's got some room to run. Tauber getting to the outside. Can he get to the corner? He can. He'll be brought down in bounds, but he'll have a big gain on the play all the way down to the 41-yard line, brought down by the defensive back Terrell Lindsay, and believe we'll have a timeout by the White Squad.
Yeah, Lindsay saved the touchdown right there on that play, and Tauber, you can see the running skills that he brings to the table is outstanding. He's a patient runner. He's not a fast guy. He's not an explosive guy, but he has great vision. And you see right there, the piano fell on his back, and defensive back was able to make a play. But that's a great job understanding what you're seeing and feeling the defense. I really like the way he runs the ball.
Let's go ahead and take a look at our pathway to the regional development camps, brought to you again by Sports Authority. Sports Authority, the official sporting goods provider of USA Football. Of course, the regional development camps. Then you get to the U.S. national team development games, one of five right here, the last one of them. And then if you get past that level, you go to represent the U.S. in the International Bowl, international competition at the International Bowl and the IFAF World Championship. So, again, this is the last of the development games. They had two in the Canton area, one down in Texas in College Station, also had one in Los Angeles. So it's really kind of the last, really the last step before the national team guys are chosen and they move on that way. So, again, it's a big day for these guys. This is really your last shot to show what you can do and kind of make your last stand.
And what I really love about this is that it's competition at every step, from the development camps to the games to the regional camps. Everywhere you go, you're going to have to compete, and that just helps them carry over into their regular life, you know, as an individual.
And we see it at some levels where, you know, guys, not about the competition, you know, they kind of get in there and guys are moving away. These guys all competitors, all guys. You look at some of the stuff, you look at the bios some of these guys have, just, you know, some high achievement guys out there and all love the game of football. Handoff up the middle, going to be a minimal gain for Prim. We brought down after one, and they're looking to go ahead and push the tempo.
And that was right there by Brian Bond, once again, staying at home, not being fooled, not biting down on the dive play and making the tackle.
Interesting two tight end formation. Now back to throw. And incomplete, looking deep for Ryan Rogu, and he can't go ahead and complete the pass. Actually, that pass intended, believe, for James McCloskey.
And that was a great play by the defender. He made that throw tougher than it had to be because he forced the quarterback to place that football closer to the hash where he really didn't want to put it. But that was a great job by the defensive back. And you want to see him turn around and find the football a little bit, but just being able to force a bad throw, it's a great thing.
So another timeout here with 29 seconds to go and looking at a third and nine. Need to take it down to the 31 for a first down. We had the intended receiver on the last play, James McCloskey, was actually listed in the programs as a defensive lineman. But, again, you see so many guys here that are two-way players. They can do a little bit of everything. So seeing him get a little chance at tight end, not a shock.
And the fact that he's a 2018 kid and has that ability to play both DN and tight end, colleges want to see that. They want to see what more can you do. And the more you can do, whether it's playing running back, like we saw Golic, and then lining up in the slot. You want to see guys do multiple things, and that just makes you that much more marketable to these colleges out there.
So a third and nine, four wide receiver set. Looked like the Red Squad had an extra guy on the field. They run one off late, no penalty there. Tauber back to throw. Some pressure coming in. Going to throw this one deep. And this time, actually was looking for Rogu. Incomplete. And decision time for the white team with not a lot of time left on the clock.
Well, Team White loves that flag route. They've ran it, I would say maybe six times so far this game, trying to hit the tight end on an arrow route or a corner route, however you want to call it. But, again, the timing isn't there like you would see from a regular season game because these guys have only been together for a week, and we don't know how often they've practiced reps with one another. So that could be something that's factored in as well.
Fourth and nine, need to get it to the 31 for a first down. Four wide receiver set, one back in the backfield alongside Tauber. That is Justin Prim. Tauber, wide snap, going to pick it up. Pressure coming again, this time looking down the sidelines and incomplete, looking intended for Aaron Johnson but broken up. That time getting in the way, Zachary Thomas not letting that ball get through.
And again, great coverage on the defensive side of the ball. And you look at Coach Cowgill's background, he's a defensive coordinator for this football team, and they've been playing excellent defense at every level. Linebackers, secondary has been covering well and pressed. They've been one-on-one throughout the course of this game. And you see right there a safety, deep safety, closing in on the ball, knocking it away, making a great play, getting off the field.
Talked about Coach Cowgill at a Daphne High School in Alabama. And interesting, yeah, to talk about how integrating a staff, this is the one that has most of the guys from Avalon School in D.C. Also, you mentioned Tommy Polly and the St. Francis Academy in Maryland and Westfield High School, Chadwick Louisville, that's where he's from. So really a local staff, but Coach Cowgill's got his guys playing no matter who's coaching with him.
Exactly, and I've seen these guys play high school football down there with his squad, and they've done a great job. I mean, excellent coach, defensive mind.
Coming on here, Jared Wagenhofer. He'll take the last snaps of the second half. We'll see exactly what they can do. Coming up close to the play clock, taking some time as Wagenhofer had to reset him. Now he'll look to set up a screen, going to run for his life, trying to keep the play alive. Throws it across his body, going to hit Golic for a five-yard gain, and we'll see if they take a timeout. Looks like the clock didn't really run at first. They're going to go ahead and take the timeout here, so they'll have at least one more play.
Of course, Golic wants the football. You want that as a playmaker. He called for it right there. Good job by Wagenhofer, making sure he was safe to throw the football, and good catch, great tackle, good play all around.
You have to like by Golic. Once he kind of got loose, started waving those arms to make himself a big target for the quarterback.
Right, and also makes you a big target for the defenders. You know, you see this guy open, now he's calling for the football. You want to stay patient. The quarterback sees you. He's trying to protect you as well and make sure you won't get sacrificed by the defensive players.
I think the sticks are wrong. They have it as fourth down. That was the first play of the drive. So we'll have one more play here, we would think. And they've resetting the clock here. Now it's going back to 10 seconds. It was down to six. So maybe actually two plays here. So may change exactly what Coach Cowgill looks to do here.
Coach is at Daphne High School, which is where we always get down to when we go down for the Senior Bowl. One practice is near in Daphne.
So he actually fixed the sticks here. So a second and five ball. The red team's own 45-yard line. Wagenhofer calling signals. Got it back beside him, the sidecar. Throws it over. Golic looking for him. This one incomplete. Collision down there. Looks like everybody's going to get up and again, looking for that interception, and you got to say the white team with three ball-hawking secondary guys kind of giving it up, trying to get that interception.
Golic didn't care. He wanted the football anyway, and you like that about him. Going across the middle, being able to, again, focus on the ball. It was a tough catch, knowing he was going to get hit by three guys at one time, but still had the wherewithal to focus to make the play.
You can see all those guys get up, and that's actually going to bring us to the end of the half, and our score is going to be 14-0, the red team up on the white team, and what's been a pretty impressive half by the red squad, Emory, and they've really been able to get some drives going, and then more importantly, finish those drives.
Well, you look at the defensive line, like we talked about in the beginning, Brian Bond has done an excellent job. And that defense has been aggressive on the red squad. You want to see the white team come out in the second half, be a little bit more aggressive, throwing the football downfield, maybe switch it up and try to find ways to move the football.
Of course, one of the big initiatives of USA football besides the development game, so many things they do, but of course one of the big ones, heads up football, the tackling technique they teach here to all, trying to teach it and spread it across America, all folks coaching football, trying to make it a safer game. Let's take a look and learn more about heads up football.
Eyes up, see what you hit. Good job, guys. Let's go, head up. Squeeze, sink,
and. When coaches get to the high school level, I think they assume that everybody who plays knows how to play, and they're going to be under Friday night lights, and everything's going to be great, and it's just like it is on TV, and it's not like that. You're going to get kids that have never played before, and you're going to get coaches, really, that have never coached before. You really need to be able to teach coaches how to coach.
Through the Heads Up program, what you do, three pillars, as they say. One, concussion awareness. Two, how to truly, properly fit equipment. Finally, here's how we're teaching the ultimate aspect of contact in tackling.
This is the basics and the fundamentals. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought as an educator, this was a curriculum for football.
Feet, squeeze, sink, hands, step.
It was really a no-brainer to get involved with USA Football and the Heads Up program.
They go through a progression of tackling. They're actually learning how to keep their head up, not to lead with their helmet, and they're taught that from the beginning.
It's limited the amount of concussions that we've had this year, basically because we have worked on heads-up tackling from day one.
Squeeze, Sink hands, right foot. Running through, sink hands. Squeeze, feet, explode. There you go, head up.
Feet, 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 feet.
Eyes up, shoot, head up.
The coaches have completely bought in and endorsed what we're doing.
Come on, get those elbows tight and high.
What we really didn't anticipate was how aggressive that the Coaches Association here in Virginia went after it, saw the need to make the game better and safer, and they ran with it.
Go heads and eyes up, heads and eyes up.
The days of popping the old smelling salt or the ammonia tabs are gone, and that's a good thing.
Shoot! Heads up football has allowed concussions to become a topic of conversation in a positive way.
Well, I just think it's standardized everything. It becomes a much more consistent way of teaching the game.
This kind of instruction keeps my staff in line.
They're seeing a distinct improvement and reduction in injury. And I think that says a lot about the program.
What this has really done, because we're hands-on with the parents now, we're showing them how the progression goes, we're teaching them the terminology as well, it brings a level of comfort to them.
I think it's really good that all the coaches are learning proper techniques on how to teach these kids to do it right.
I am so relieved that they're teaching this to these kids at such a young age, because I was never taught that.
In our family room, Britton will show us, and demonstrate on his dad, not his mom.
Hey, break down. Hey. Eyes up, see what you hit.
Job done.
Today's game brought to you by Marriott, the official hotel partner of USA Football and the U.S. national teams. It's also brought to you by FieldTurf, the official field building grant partner of USA Football. Again, at the half, the red team leading the white team 14-0. Jeremy Huber, Emery Hunt back with you here high above the field at Towson University. And again, a wonderful game so far. We've seen a lot of good things, especially from the red team. And Emery, quick thoughts on the first half.
Excellent defensive play by the red squad. Pressure, bust, pipes, and they did a great job applying pressure to Team White.
Yeah, and again, it's been a wonderful half of football for the red team. The white team obviously going to be looking to do some different things. I guess, quickly, what do you think the white team needs to kind of do to kind of get themselves rolling in the second half?
I would say establish a running game. They've not been able to establish a run. I know that's tough to do with the defensive line, but they have to do a better job of enforcing their will up front.
We'll see exactly what they can do. Of course, three games today here at Towson. One of the coaches from the second game standing by with our Jack Feely.
Thanks very much, guys. Coach, how many years have you been involved with USA Football, and what are you most looking forward to today in today's game versus Sylvester in the next game?
This is my second year. I did Towson last year, then I was a defense coordinator in Dallas last year, which was an amazing experience, and then so came back this year. We spent a lot of time this week trying to build a team culture. So I want to see if that shows some fruit during the game. We ask the kids to support each other, get to know each other, make some lifelong friends. And so I'm excited to see how we play.
Is it difficult from a coach's perspective getting kids from all over the country and trying to mix them in with such limited time?
Yeah, I think so. I think I have an advantage because I'm in a boarding school. So I've got kids from 32 states on my team. So we do this at our school. But it is, and we did some great meetings. Kids really shared from their heart, and I really think they got to know each other.
You talk about your boarding school experience. This is your 11th year at Woodbury Forest. In fact, you coach Kyle Bilodeau, who caught that first half touchdown. Talk about his ceiling and how USA Football Development Camp will really raise his stock.
He's been a long time Team USA guy. It's actually one of the ways I found out about it. It's really helped him. Kyle's probably the most polished tight end I've ever had. He could literally coach the position. Supposed to be 6'7". I think he's certainly a D1 guy, and he catches everything he touches. So not a bad prospect.
Coach, thanks very much. Enjoy the game.
Thank you.
Back to you guys.
Thank you, Jack, and thank you to head coach Clint Alexander of Woodbury Forest, also coaching in the second game. Again, our second of three games here today at Towson. Really looking forward to seeing all the matchups. Of course, let's go ahead and take a look at our first half highlights. And again, a lot of them mostly for the red squad. Seeing here as the red team getting it down on the end of their field, and then again hitting Kyle Bilodeau for the touchdown.
Just a great throw. You know, again, ball placement is everything for a quarterback. That ties into your accuracy, and that's why he was able to make the play for the touchdown.
ability would get up a little bit slow, but looks hoping he's okay. So then we would see again the red team moving it down the field. This one, our play of the game. It's a guy who's really been getting it done on the offense, Mike Golick, making the long catch on the play, as again coming out of the slot, as you said, and looking like a wide receiver.
Basically looking like Lynn Twine versus the Cowboys in the Super Bowl. Great concentration, great catch, and like you said, the play of the game already.
Yeah, the play of the game brought to you by Shock Doctor. And again, what a play there by Golick to go ahead and his chair fired up. And then that would lead his team down in position. And then we would go ahead and see again another hookup, this time coming from the quarterback, Gerald Filardi, and going ahead and hooking up there for the touchdown to Jaden Brunson.
Yeah, you see that wide receiver lineup far out wide, nearly to the sideline. You know that slant is coming. And that was a great job executing the play by the quarterback and receiver.
And those highlights brought to you by Sports Authority, the official sporting goods provider of USA Football. So a quick halftime. We're ready for second half action, and getting it to the outside and dragging his way for a first down is Jared Wagenhofer. And again, seeing a lot of damage done on the ground from these quarterbacks.
And this is another time where we've seen a quarterback, running back, not be on the same page with the midline read right here. Quarterback goes one way, running back goes the other. The opposite, and the quarterback decides to eat it and gains positive yards, picks up first.
Yeah, Wagenhofer, a little bit bigger than Filardi, the guy he's splitting reps with, and obviously kind of getting it done there. We mentioned Caesar Rodney was the starting quarterback as a freshman, so he's a guy that has a shot to be a four-year starter and could be a very good one.
It's good to see a lot of these 2018 guys in this game. You know, that's big for them, for their development moving forward.
First and 10 after the Wagenhofer first down on the first play of the second half. We again in the pistol. Only the most of the game the Red Squad's been in that. Pitch out almost taken away by the defensive end. That one pitched out to number 23, Keenan Perez Phillips. But again, getting back there and making a big play. I believe that was James McCloskey.
McCloskey did a great job getting upfield and staying at home. And again, timing is everything. Everything has to operate as it's drawn up, otherwise it could throw it off. And that's what happened with this snap, the gather, and the pitch. Everything was thrown off just a half a second, and it allowed McCloskey to get back there and make a play.
McCloskey, that quick move up the field, almost there to catch the pitch. Instead, it ends up being a no gain. Actually, a loss, excuse me, on the play, all the way back to the 30-yard line. So need to take it up to the 46 for a first down. That sets up a second and 16. Handoff up the middle, breaking one tackle. Can't break the second, coming from the running back spot again, Perez Phillips, and had just one arm tackle there, kept him from making that gain even bigger.
And Perez Phillips, I know the feeling, man. You want to break that second tackle. Otherwise, and he would have been off to the races because he did a great job breaking the first wave, and it's now that second wave right there. And it would have been a foot race, so you know he's wishing he had that one back.
Getting that hand out there, Eric DeMayo again of Peabody, Massachusetts. DeMayo goes to Peabody Veterans. Interesting on him. I see two interesting points on him. Favorite player, Bo Jackson. Interesting to see guys of this age, not guys of our age. We saw Bo play. These guys, at least it's only been on video.
Right, and that's why you love those 30 for 30 specials, those SEC storage specials. These guys get a chance to see why we love Bo Jackson and guys like Herschel Walker.
Wagenhofer trying to set up the screen and will not get anything out of it again. DeMayo on the spot. Also there, Nigel Reddick to go ahead and shut that play down and set up a punting situation for the red team.
Scott Taylor, the defensive coordinator for Team White, you see what has been the emphasis coming out of the half. Be a little bit more aggressive, be a little bit more technically sound, and they have done a great job getting Team Red off the field.
So a three and out for the, not a three and out because Wagenhofer did get that first down, but after that first down, the White squad shutting down the Red squad. So again, on to punt will be Bentley Faulkner. Again, punting for both teams. You actually see him wearing both jerseys out there, wearing the white top and the red pants. That's why, as he's kind of splitting his allegiances. But Faulkner just trying to show what he can do. Another pretty good punt. And coming up and fielding it at the 35-yard line, Cameron Wicks. So that's where the white squad will scrimmage from as they look for their first points of the game.
Yeah, they have to come out. You saw the defensive side come out with great aggression and great aggressiveness. And you want to see the offensive side do the same thing. Try to get the passing game going, a short passing game. They try to connect deep a little bit more. Short passing game could help them out instantly.
This broadcast brought to you by Upper Deck, the official trading card partner of USA Football and the U.S. national teams. Broadcast also brought to you by Volt Athletic, the official strength and conditioning solutions partner of the U.S. national team. Again, going to be Ben Tauber. Looks like he's going to go the rest of the way as Weston Cook went down earlier in the game after being sacked hard. Haven't seen him back in since. And Tauber actually playing very well out there. Slant pattern going to be complete. Positive yardage to Cameron Wicks. Give him a gain of about 6 on the play.
And Wicks was the guy that dropped the pass earlier in the same situation. Dropped the quick slant. Caught this one. You know, again, short gains will eventually lead to the bigger ones down the line. But this is a positive play that you need coming out of the half.
So, second and 4, that will set up. Again, we saw Tauber in the first half, the quarterback for the White squad, really make most of his plays with his feet. But again, love to see get a little bit of that passing game going, as we really haven't seen too many big plays through the air.
And you see the pressure coming back out of the half by Team Red once again, but you have to be able to beat pressure if you're Team White.
Tauber gets the snap out of the shotgun. He'll look long this time. It's going to be incomplete. Looked like a little bit of a hold, and it will come in from the outside. Is going out for the pass out of the backfield with Speltz, and he gets held, and that's going to be at least 10, maybe 15.
And that was a great job by Tauber reading the defense, because we saw the soft coverage in the slot trying to force him to go to that slant. He came back across the field to the wheel route to the back and was able to make a great read, and we saw he drew the flag for the penalty. You see right here again. You see at the top in the slot, they were trying to dictate that throw, but he waited, stayed patient, came to the one-on-one matchup on the outside, and it was holding on a defensive player. But that was a great job by the QB, not being influenced by what the defense wanted him to do.
It's like Richard Kardashian gets called for it. See Chris Merritt, the head coach of the White squad, of course, played at Indiana, was the head coach at Columbus High School from 2001 to present, also played for the Hamburg Blue Devils, and again was a Coach of the Year finalist for both in Dade County and the Miami Dolphins. So, again, a guy who's coached a pretty high level, sharing his knowledge out here today. Tauber trying to get to the outside. He'll step out of bounds after a nice gain of about 8 on the play.
What was interesting was looking at Brian Bond again. Forcing him to go to the outside is forcing him to get to the sideline. He actually was able to pursue well after redirecting, flattening out, great pursuit angle to try to get him to pin to that sideline and actually made the play. Great play by Tauber, but even better play by Bond.
Yeah, Brian Bond obviously showing his wares today. Danny Cowgill, the head coach of the Red team, played at Lenoir Rhine in North Carolina, been the head coach at Daphne High School, just started last year, but you see all the schools he's been at, another high-level coach out there for these guys. Handoff up the middle on the give, and it's going to be very close to the sticks as Speltz with the carry.
It's been death by 1,000 cuts right now coming out of the half. This is a great opening drive for Team White. Again, this is how you fight pressure. You run right at it. You attack it where it's coming from, and they've done a great job this drive coming out of out of halftime.
Let's send it back down to the field to our Jack Feely.
Hey, guys. As you can tell by the scoreboard, 14-0 in favor of Danny Cowgill's squad. It's easy to say that momentum is favoring the Red squad right now as we begin as we continue to claw our way through the third quarter. I had a chance to sneak into the Merritt defensive huddle where I overheard assistant coach Mike Kerper really imploring his team to wake up and ratchet up the intensity, whether that's bursting off the line quicker or being able to just get some team camaraderie. When I walked over, you could literally hear a pin drop. It was so silent. So Kerper trying to ratchet up the intensity and trying to get his team back into this game any which way he can.
Thanks, Jack. Yeah, and looks like Coach Merritt's message has been received. Emery looking for a little more intensity. His team really getting one of their better drives of the game so far.
And you saw in a previous play, going back to that slant in the bubble at the top of the screen, he put great placement on the ball to where the receiver had to catch it on his outside shoulder, which kept him safe from the defender.
Tauber going to keep it on the read option up the middle. Again, it'll be close to the sticks. And again, you almost have to wonder, Emery, at this point, since Tauber, it looks like they may be going with him the rest of the way, is he getting into a rhythm because he's getting a chance to play multiple series in a row?
That's a great point you made right there, because again, these games, whether it be all-star or development games, guys are splitting reps. They don't get that continuity within the series, and he's doing that, and you see him getting to a groove. You also see the offensive line getting to a groove because we haven't said how great the defensive line of Team Red has been in this second half because Team White has done a great job firing off the football. They're controlling the tempo and pace right now in this game.
And a first down there by Tauber, again, leading his team down the field, looking for their first score of the game, joined in the backfield by Speltz. Tauber looking to throw over the middle. This one almost picked off. It was trying to get that one in to Rashawn Bray instead. Almost picked off by Tyler Honey.
Tyler Honey out of Old Bridge, New Jersey, Central Jersey kid. Ball hit him in the stomach. He wished he has that play back because, again, he was following his man. He was following the receiver, but the ball came whizzing through, and it could have been a big play. That's the type of play you have to make defensively because right now the team is on their heels.
Honey, as you mentioned, a Jersey guy out of Old Bridge, also a wrestler. See a lot of that here. A lot of the defensive linemen, a lot of the linebackers come off the wrestling mats. And, again, you learn so many of those skills of leverage when it comes to wrestling, and some of these guys are showing it very well today. Tauber going to keep up the middle. He's going to be grabbed by Bond and pulled back, and Bond doing his buddy a solid, doesn't throw him all the way back, just holds his progress.
Bond is a guy that I've seen, 12 minutes into this game and you know, or into this second half, or 8 minutes into the second half, and he's a guy that has great football IQ. He doesn't get fooled by fakes. He doesn't get fooled by influence. He's always where he's supposed to be, and he's making a play. He's a good football player.
I tell you, Bond's definitely got to be a candidate for defensive player of the game. Had a sack earlier on, really has been in the backfield. And as you mentioned, even plays where he's gotten beat, he showed the hustle to make up for it later on, and at least keeping it from becoming a very big game.
Well-coached kid, man.
Third and 10 here. Tauber going to roll to his left, looking for something open. Bond in his face. That's going to be incomplete. And again, making another big play is number 74, Brian Bond.
And Speltz, I feel you on that one, my man. You're a running back, and they ask you to go out and attack the defensive lineman, especially one that has been playing well like Bond. It's a tough task to do. He did what he could, but not enough to where Bond didn't disrupt that pass.
So now we'll see the first real test for Bentley Faulkner in this contest as he'll look to go ahead and kick a field goal. Remember, no rush on this, but it will be a lengthy kick. Going to spot it down at about the 32-yard line. So it'll be a 32-yarder, and they'll kick it from almost at the right hash mark.
Kickers are worth their weight in gold if they can hit these long-distance kicks.
See the red team jumping up and down, trying to distract. Faulkner will kick this one through. Should have the distance, but it is wide to the left. So the white team still able to get on the scoreboard in this one. And the red team will take over, looking to add to their lead.
And again, you drive down the field. You take up what looks like 7 minutes on a drive. Now you go to the sideline. You get coached up. You know you can move the football against this team. We can move the football. We did it with the short passing game. We did a little with a little bit of quarterback run. Now can our defense step up and get the ball back so we can finish what we started on that first drive?
This game brought to you by Flip Give, an official fundraising partner of USA Football. Also brought to you by Gatorade, the official sports fuel provider of USA Football. Luckily for us, we don't need the Gatorade. We're upstairs a little bit out of the heat, but these guys down the field obviously going to need to put some of those electrolytes back in. First and 10 for the Red Squad. Filardi back in, started the game. Throws that one high, looking over the middle for Golic, who's really been the offensive standout so far in this contest. Incomplete.
Play was a little discombobulated from the start. Snap was a little late. You know, looks like some guys didn't know the ball was ready to go, ready for play, and that threw off the entire timing of the play.
Seen a lot of screen passes so far in this one. Do you think there's any reason for that?
Well, you want to get the ball out quickly. You want to allow these guys to show their athleticism. And if they're playing pressure, it's a good call versus pressure. But we've seen a lot of zone from Team White. So you want to see Team Red start to go deep down the field throwing the football.
Filardi joined by Golic in the backfield. Got three wide receivers and a tight end. Looks for the slant. That one's complete. Should be first down yardage out across the 35, down at the 36. Again, Florida, good job on the timing to go ahead and hook up with Jaden Brunson.
And that's one thing we saw yesterday, what I saw yesterday as far as throwing the football is concerned versus man coverage. They want him to hold the ball, wait till he crosses face, and then fire it in there. And it's a great job showing what you were coached and translating it to the field. And so that shows that Filardi is a well-coached kid.
Again, we talked about it. His father, Gerald Filardi Sr., was a linebacker of note at Penn State. Now Golic, a guy of note in this game, trying to get the outside, almost stays on his feet and breaks the last tackle. Instead, he'll be hit and brought down, a little pushing and shoving, and flags go out immediately. But Golic's going to get that one all the way out to the 44-yard line, just 2 yards short of the first down, and we'll see what the flags are. But wonderful run there by Golic again.
Golic runs with attitude, and you like that from the running back position. Running with attitude allows you to break arm tackles, and we've seen him break many arm tackles this game. But that was an excellent tackle by Charles Robinson, the defensive back from Elmira, New York. And I'm going to test your football knowledge here. Who else came from Elmira? Ernie Davis.
That's right. You know, I did see that in the prep for the game. The million of things I was prepping right. for. That one's the one I forget. The Elmira Express?
Yep, the Elmira Express. But that was a great play all around. You saw Golic break tackles and Robinson save what could have been an even bigger game by finishing him off because he was going to keep his footing.
Now, interesting. Thought that might be personal fouls both ways, I should say. Instead, they call it on the white team. So 15 yards, a first down, and into the white team's territory. So, again, if you're on the sidelines, Coach Merritt can't be happy with his team giving up those free yards. Filardi pump fakes, looking to go deep. Nothing there. He's going to have to run. Look, just throw it away. And that one, will we see a flag go down? Coach Merritt calling for it, and he will get it.
But you saw right there, that's a good adjustment by Team White. What we've talked about throughout the course of this game, wide receivers' alignments. They, again, are lined up to the far side of the field, put everybody short side, showing that we're going to go slant. They took it away, and that forced Filardi to hold on to the football, and they forced him to throw it, grounding? And that's now we have a penalty. So that was great defensive play right there, defensive recognition by Team White.
So a five-yard penalty, and it will be a loss of down. Actually going to move it back more than 5 yards. Going to move it back to the spot of where he threw the ball. So they'll have that all the way back. They'll put it back on the 45-yard line of the red squad, and it'll should move to second down. So they haven't redone the change yet. They will go ahead and flip it now. So the red team has a long way to go. Need to take it all the way down to the 31-yard line for a first down.
Now Team White presses, which is good in this situation.
Filardi going deep, looking for his man. That one almost incomplete, then almost caught on the rebound as both guys giving good effort there.
And that's a great job, again, defensively understanding the situation. Now you have these guys backed up. Now we're going to send pressure. We're going to press on the outside. You're going to have to make a tight throw, and it was almost picked off by the free safety. He actually should have caught that ball, but again, good job by the receiver staying alive and almost coming away with the catch.
Looks like Charles Robinson out of Elmira with that almost interception as Filardi tried to go deep. So now a third and long, and interesting to see where the red team will go here. They've been pretty good on screen game. You think they might go that route?
You would think just try to get some yards back so that way they can make it an easier punt, pin these guys deep.
So we'll see what Coach Calgill does, and maybe more importantly what Coach Bryson Spinner calls, the offensive coordinator, as he looks at least to get some field position back for his team. Filardi looking to his right, going to throw this one deep. That one looking for Golic, and he got turned around like an outfielder on a bad fly ball and incomplete for the red squad.
I love the aggressiveness, though, going for the first down. If he was able to come down with that ball, it would have made it an interesting fourth down decision. It would have been fourth and about two. But you love the aggressiveness right there, going for the first down, not sacrificing and just going just to get a little bit of yards there and putting the football.
So fourth and long, we'll bring on Bentley Faulkner. Again, he'll continue his kicking duties, doing it for both squads in this one as we're under 90 seconds to go in the third quarter. Faulkner takes his time. High kick, And a little miscommunication there again, and eventually jumping on it is Robinson after Wicks misplayed it. Wicks tried to go back and bounced off his shoulder, and Robinson, Johnny, on the spot just to go ahead and stop it, and they'll go ahead and mark it dead at the 15-yard line.
That's a great punt, by the way. Again, I've been impressed with the punting in this football game. Great directional punting and good hang time on this last one.
So 15-yard line for the white team as they look for their first score of the game with 1:12 left to go. And again, checking out the huddle, looks like we may have a new quarterback into the game. It's going to be Nathan Floysand, his first action of the matchup.
And Floysand has had a really good week out here with the coaching staff. One of the guys they spotlighted as a player to watch and who has been having a great week. So excited to see him play.
Floysand out of Cottage Grove, Minnesota, goes to Park High School, and he'll get his first action of the matchup. Handoff up the middle. Looked like it could be a big gainer for a second, and then stuffed in the hole, as it'll be a minimal gain there for the white squad.
Yeah, Matthew Matrakas out of Tuckahoe, New York, a Long Island kid, making a great play, filling that gap in and stopping the running back in his tracks.
So, gain of one on the play. Going to bring up a second and nine. We'll see what type of pace. Looked like he had a pretty good pace going for the white squad earlier in the half. And we'll see with the new quarterback and how fast they're able to go. That last carry made by Brennan Richardson, the running back out of West Creek, New Jersey. Under 30 seconds to play here in the third quarter. White team looking for their first score of the game. Three wide receivers for Nathan Floysand. Looking over the red team defense with a big defensive line. Floysand going to be brought down, and again, it's the guy we've talked about all game long, Brian Bond, with a big hit.
Bond does a great job beating his block and getting to the quarterback, and you saw the play they were trying to set up on that one. They're the tight formation, and they had the back offset to the right. So what they were trying to do is get the back on a wheel route, run a slant with the receiver, and the back was open, but you have to have time to hit that play. That's a long developing play, and they didn't have the time because of Bond.
Red team with a 14-0 lead on the white team after the end of three quarters. Let's take a quick break here at Towson.
I got plans.
Woo! I'm going places.
Here I come.
I got plans to pick myself up.
I will gain trust.
I'm going to earn everything I get.
I got plans to command your respect.
I've got plans to push my limits.
I got plans to be great.
Let's go, get in.
Today's broadcast brought to you by Siege Sports, the official uniform provider of the U.S. national teams. Also brought to you by Physio Control, the official AED provider of USA football. Right now, the red team with a 14-0 lead on the white team here in our USA football development games. Of course, the white team coached by Chris Merritt, the red team coached by Danny Cowgill. Actually, the team official names in our paperwork is Team Cowgill and Team Merritt, but to keep it easy for the folks at home, kind of going with the red and the white.
And you look at that defensive line awakening the last few plays for Team Red. I don't know if that's because of the new quarterback or just because they got coached up on the sideline and having to do a better job in this second drive, and I think it's a little bit of both.
So Floysand will come back out. His first action of the game after most of it taken. The first half was split between Ben Tauber and Weston Cook. Cook went down after a big sack, and then Tauber had taken most of the reps, actually all the reps in the second half, but now seeing Floysand getting a chance to go ahead and show off what he can do. Four wide receivers. Floysand back to throw, looking deep, trying to connect. That one's going to be incomplete. Don't know if he would have got his foot down anyway, but was looking for Aaron Johnson. Couldn't make the connection.
You like Floysand going down the sideline, being aggressive, going for the first down. If this was Canada, it would have been a complete pass because he had a little bit more room to work with, but that's a great job by the defensive back to recover and pin that receiver to the sideline.
On the coverage there, 27, Makai Self, one of the local guys out of Upper Marlboro, Maryland, plays for St. John's College High School, one of the top programs in the Washington, D.C. area.
It's a great play by a guy that's in the 10th grade, going into the 10th grade to recover and then pin the receiver to the sideline.
Faulkner again on to punt, as we mentioned. Doing it for both teams today. This one end over end and coming up and unable to go ahead and get it before it hits. So it's going to get a little extra roll on it and be down at the 48-yard line. So, again, having some trouble with Faulkner's punts. And I tell you, Emery, we're looking at this game where there's no rush. There's nobody coming down the field. When he has a guy blocking for him and he has guys covering his kicks, he's got to be heck to deal with because guys don't seem to be able to get his kicks today.
Exactly. It's the way the ball spins. As a returner, you have to try to judge, okay, where can I set myself up to get under it? And if the ball is spinning funny, you're never going to be able to judge it, and you're going to have those situations that you see out there now.
You saw a shot of the teams for the next game coming in. Tentative 11 o'clock start time, though, again, I believe that's actually a little bit later than that. It might actually be an 11 o'clock start time tentative, but we'll see if that one holds. Again, we'll be here for all three games today, the USA football development games. Now, pitch out. Golic going to throw it back, maybe going for the double pass. They will, and that one's going to be complete down the field. And still on his feet and cutting it back. And what a play there for the Red Squad as Roger Holcomb, the guy who gets it after the pitch, the throwback, both guys getting a chance at it, then eventually getting it down the field, and Holcomb the recipient.
And we saw this play earlier in the first half where Golic decided to run the football. Now they do execute the double pass. And Holcomb, a guy out of Baltimore, Maryland, did a great job, great individual effort to make the guy miss. He was tackled. Dead to rights right here, fight through, make a tackle, hold on to the football, and then try to make one miss again. Great individual effort.
Of course, Golic throwing it back to Wagenhofer, who got it down the field to Holcomb. So another big gain for the Red Squad. They will have it at the 24-yard line of the white team. Pistol formation again. Golic up the middle. Going to be hit and brought down, but again, drag some tacklers for a 3-yard gain.
Yeah, you like the fact that they're still in attack mode. They got a 14-0 lead, but they're still in attack mode, trying to put more on the board to close this game out.
You see it, Mike Golic trying to cement what he's done so far today, as he's really been a guy who's kind of made the engine run for the Red Squad. Second and 7, we'll call it. Need to take it down to the 14-yard line for a first down.
Too deep look here.
Wagenhofer again in the shotgun. Golic, the sidecar next to him. Going to throw this one deep, looking for a score. He's got a score. Touchdown, Red Team, as Wagenhofer able to hook up with John Gregory for 6.
You talk about a classic drop in the bucket throw. Wagenhofer beat cover 2. Where you can beat cover 2, down the middle of the field or in the hole in between the corner and the safety, and he put that ball perfectly in the hole where the receiver didn't have to break stride. He ran underneath it, caught it, touchdown. That was a great throw. Right here, safety is on his horse trying to get over there, but you can't defend the perfect pass.
John Gregory out of Indian Land, South Carolina. It was Indian Land High School, and he goes into the end zone for 6. Kick is up, and the kick is good. So now a 21-0 lead for the Red Team as they are really kind of getting it going in this contest and look very good. Let's go ahead and get it down to our Jack Feely on the sidelines.
Hey guys, thanks very much. One of the questions that I had coming into when we were broadcasting this is how do you balance the competitive nature of these players with friendly competition? And one thing that we noticed on that last drive for Merritt's squad was when Aaron Johnson was throwing the ball towards the near sideline. And Terrell Lindsey came over and laid a pretty good hit on him. It was good to see that both the players got up, slapped each other, high five. Lindsey asking Aaron Johnson, are you all right? Johnson simply replied, it's football. And Emery, I'm sure you know that camaraderie is everything. And that's what USA football is really trying to preach here at the developmental games.
Thank you, Jack. Again, yeah, it's a camaraderie building thing. It is a development camp for the national team, but at its heart, Emery, it's a football camp, and these guys are getting good instruction. They're making some friends that, who knows, they may have for life.
Exactly, and you learn by doing it, and you're being able to go against guys that you're going to see throughout the course of their high school career for the next 3 years.
Busted play. Looked like things were stopped, and they were expecting a whistle instead. Floisan going to get kind of wrapped up by the defensive front for no gain. Actually, see, they go ahead and reset this or just go second down. We're going to have a timeout. That's what we'll do now, as the white team didn't like what they just saw there. And interesting, it looked like they just kind of put it back at the same spot. They're going to go to the second down, though. So 21-0 is our score, as the white team looking for their first score of the game. And, you know, Emory, they've been there, but they just haven't been able to kind of get over that hump. They've had a couple of decent drives that kind of got snuffed out by different reasons. It'll be interesting to see here if under Floisand they can get something going, something positive here as we get closer to the end of the game.
And it looks like with Floisand, they're going more to their passing game as opposed to when Tauber is in there, they're running the football a little bit more with his legs. So we'll see if they're going to speed up the tempo, speed up the pace. Now you look back at why certain things in the game matter. Every point adds up, and they really did that field goal. That would have made this an interesting a drive here for the white team.
So a second and 10 here with just under 10 minutes to play here in our first of three USA football development games here at Towson University, just outside of Baltimore, Maryland. Floisand with his second straight drive. The youngster out of Cottage Grove, Minnesota, going to hand it off up the middle, and not a lot of running room there, and brought down on the play, getting into the hole and making a nice tackle there. At least someone that's actually listed on our program. We'll have to check out that number a little bit later on. But again, doing a good job there, kind of stuffing the hole.
That was Adam Hart out of Pine Bush, New York, filling that hole right there, number 64. And that was a real good tackle, you know, good sound tackle right there to stop the run. You saw a double tight end set, which tells you they probably were going to run their football.
Prim on that last carry. You saw Hart just swallowing up and didn't let him get much of anything. Floisand up the middle. He'll be hit low and brought down after a gain of about 5 on the play, but still going to be well short of the first down. So we'll see if the white team decides to punt it away or if they'll go for it.
Another double tight end set, which is a rarity in today's game, which means they're coming downhill. A little power play right there, a little counter. But again, good feel right there by the linebacker making the play for minimal gain and forcing these guys to make a decision on fourth down.
It looks like the decision has been made by Coach Merritt, and this his team will go for it. And actually going to be a little closer to 3 yards here. Need to get it to the 35. Ball marked right now at the 32. Floisand again with the two tight end set. Receivers each way. Floisand up the middle. Going to get past the sticks. Looked like he had two chances at getting tackled. Eventually gets by and able to go ahead and get first down yardage and move the sticks.
Yeah, Hart had him in the backfield. Had a chance to get off the field for this defense. But great job by Floisand breaking a tackle and getting the first down.
We'll see it here, Emory. Just up the middle and twice could have been brought down.
And those are the little things that add up to when you look at it on the back end, like, okay, where could we have had success as a defense? Getting off the field right there was key. They didn't get the job done.
Floisand obviously got a little room to fill out, but again, should be a very wonderful player by the time it's all said and done. That'll be a gain of 5 out to the 41-yard line.
And you mentioned it, he's only a 10th grader going in. And from his frame, you can see he can pack on about a good 20 pounds, a good muscle and good lean muscle, and be a full fit, filled out prospect by the time he's a senior.
Justin Prim on that last carry. Prim out of Fairfax High School in Fairfax, Virginia. His father actually served 23 years in the military, and he was one of the guys who kind of talked about how much of an honor this is to represent his country. Obviously, that's got to come in part from his father serving his country for that long of a time. Floisand going to be brought down in the backfield on the read option. Maybe gets it back to the line of scrimmage, though more likely loses about a yard.
Mark White out of Baltimore with a great individual effort on that tackle, because, again, that could have been a big play by the quarterback. He made the tackle in space, got Floisand on the ground.
So a loss of 1 on the play. That's going to bring up a 3rd and 7. Need to get it out to the 46-yard line for a first down. And looks like Floisand's going to come out and Ben Tauber is going to come back in. So a little swap mid-series. Don't usually see that. But, again, I think Coach Merritt trying to get something going here, as they'll bring Tauber back in, who was so good with his feet throughout the game.
And they probably see something right now with this defense and how they can attack it out, that double tight end set running the football with the QB. and they're going right back to that double tight end set now with Tauber, so I'm pretty sure you're going to see him running with the football.
Tauber with the back next to him. He's going to fake the handoff, look to go deep. Had a man for a second. He'll still get him and finally gets the completion for a big gain across the 35-yard line down to the 32 as Jafir Gillette Spio able to go ahead and bring that one in for the big gain.
Gillette Spio did a good job coming out of his break, and they tried to hit this flag route all game long, and he finally connected on a big play downfield. Great play.
And you got to give credit here. This one a little bit underthrown, but Gillette Spio did a good job to adjust to it.
Exactly, and was able to bring it down and get positive yards. Again, you have to be able to get those chunk plays when you're down 21. That was a huge play right there for Team White.
So a first and 10 as Team White looks to break the ice, and this handoff to Prim going to be no gain, but a flag goes in, and we'll have to see what this call is.
Well, it's interesting that they brought Floyd Sand back in after that one pass play. Tauber was able to throw the football deep down the field in the midst of pressure.
Let's see. Looks like this is going to be against the White team as it will be holding with the coach Calgill, and he said throw him back. So with 5:36 to go, that's going to push things back, and obviously you would think it's going to be four down territory the rest of the way for the White team. And now they'll have to go ahead and get 20 yards instead of 10 after that penalty on the play.
I mean, you look at the coaching staff by Team Red, it's a lot of defensive guys, so you can understand the attitude that this team plays with.
Thank our sponsors today, some of the fine sponsors, CVS Minute Clinic, Marriott, Field Turf, and Upper Deck, some of our wonderful sponsors here of the USA Football Development Games. First and 20, need to get it down to the 23 for a first down for the White team to go ahead and keep things going at their first score of the game. Floyd Sand going to pitch it to Prim. Prim trying to get to the corner. He'll go ahead, take a pop, and his helmet will come off, and he'll be knocked out of bounds just across the 40 down around the 36.
We haven't said these guys' names a lot, but the cornerbacks for the Red team have been doing an excellent job because they haven't been able to throw the football with effectiveness or any type of consistency as Team White. But the cornerbacks have done a great job. That's a good thing that we haven't been able to call their names. And it's a good run right here. Just trying to get positive yards. You want to keep that helmet on. But good job getting outside.
Prim's going to go out of the game. And into the contest will be Jonathan Speltz. Speltz and Prim have split most of the time at running back today for the White team. Floyd Sand tried to throw. Not there, and again, Brian Bond with another sack. A whale of a game for Brian Bond today. That one a bit easier than the other one he got earlier in the game, but again, just as effective.
If Bond is playing like this, and he plays this way throughout the course of the season, he's going to be an All-American. This is a guy that has done a great job versus the run, versus the pass, getting pressure in pursuit. Every level of defensive line play, technique-wise, we've seen from him. We've seen good technique. So he's been an impressive player in this ball game.
Yeah, definitely. I think our odds-on choice for the player of the game, that he would be the one on the defensive side of things, as he really has got it done in all phases of the defense. Third down here, third and long for the White squad. Floyd Sand back to pass, looking to go deep, trying to get a play here, and he will get one all the way down and will have first down yardage at the 20-yard line. Great adjustment by Aaron Johnson to get the big play.
Yeah, Aaron Johnson did a great job seeing the football and understanding, like, hey, I have to make a play. We have to generate something big for our offense. Coming back to the football, defensive back was in great position, but his back is turned to the ball. Johnson coming back and making a play.
The underthrow by Floyd Sand, very effective as Johnson out of Joppa, Maryland, able to go ahead and make a big play there. Johnson actually was on a team last year that won the 2A Maryland state title and finished number one in the D.C. metro area. So he's been a guy who has looked really good in this game so far. First and 10 at the 20, Floyd Sand. Fakes the handoff, takes it up the middle. Floyd Sand's got a nice gain. He'll take it all the way down near the 5-yard line. Give him 13.
And like a giraffe with the long gait, he slowly moved his way down the field, but he was gaining yards and took a pretty good shot. But, again, he's a big kid, and you could tell he's going to be a guy that's going to probably get to about 220, 230 by the time he's a senior. That was a heck of a run by Floyd Sand.
Yeah, you know, we keep talking about it. Got a skinny frame, but again, a tough kid right there, as you just showed, and a guy that will be able to fill out. If, as all these guys do, they all train so well, you got a feeling he'll be a guy to watch moving forward. So that'll bring up a first and goal here. Ball on the 7-yard line, coming up on the 2-minute mark to go in regulation. The White looking for their first score of the game. Prim joining Floysand in the backfield. Two tight ends set, receivers each way. Floysand hands off to Prim. Prim's going to be in for the score. So the White team breaks the ice as Justin Prim scores the first touchdown of the game for the White team, and they have got a touchdown on the board.
Prim out of Fairfax, Virginia, exploding through the hole. That quickness that we normally see from guys from that area. Excellent play. Way to get on the scoreboard with a run right down that A-gap. This offensive line for Team White has been playing a lot better in the second half.
So, again, Faulkner wanted to kick the extra point. I believe his holder will be playing in our second game. Probably doing the same thing that Faulkner's doing in this one. Kick is up by Faulkner, and the kick is good. So 21-7, the lead cut down to two scores for the White squad, and this is one of the drawbacks of the fact that the way they run the special teams here as we take a look at the replay, and Prim with a nice run, Emery.
Yeah, good combo block right there on the center, getting that hole open, clearing that space out, allowing the running back the freedom to run through. And these guys are doing a great job up front because they're getting position, attacking half a man and washing guys down. Running back had an easy job just to waltz into the end zone.
Now, as I was saying, if this was a game at the high school season, you'd be seeing an onside kick here as the White team would try and get the ball back. No timeouts on the scoreboard, so we're not exactly sure how many the White team has left. I believe they have all three left, so they're going to go ahead and try and get a stop here. And we'll see if they're able to go ahead and do it. Filardi in at quarterback for the Red Squad. He'll hand off to Golic up the middle. He'll be tripped up and gets a gain of two.
And what you want to see in this situation is how quickly these defensive linemen get off the block and make a play. And you don't want to get too aggressive because you're going to get hit with a play like we just saw, a draw play up the middle that could have popped for a big gain. If they can get off the field, it makes it a lot interesting to shrink this gap a little bit. Maybe not come all the way back, but shrink the gap, maybe get another touchdown on the scoreboard.
So a second and 8 here. Filardi and Golic in the backfield, 3 wide receivers. Filardi going to hand off to Golic again, who will go ahead, push for, actually going to be kept by Filardi, and he'll get hit from back and from the front. He'll be brought down after a gain of 5. Let's go ahead and throw it down to Jack on the sidelines.
All right, guys, thanks very much. I'm here with head coach Josh Sylvester of the Sylvester Red Squad right behind us. Coach, this is your first year involved with USA football. What are your thoughts so far on the setup of the development games?
It's an amazing program to be a part of. You know, it's been a pleasure to be here all week. There's great coaches and amazing kids. You know, they put character first here, a lot of ability, but also great kids all around.
What were some of the things that you were teaching your kids this week? You got a ton of kids from all over the place. How do you, with such a short amount of time, how do you try and make them such a cohesive group in so little time?
Well, we just preach that's family first. You know, some of these kids have never met. Like you said, they come from all walks of life. But when you play football together for a week, you become brothers. So hopefully they have some relationships that will last a lifetime.
What are some things you're looking forward to in the game today?
I'm really excited about both sides of the ball, to be honest with you. You have a lot of good players that are going to be definitely playing at a high level. Some guys to highlight, Charles Benton, he's a corner for us. He's a great player. Isaiah is one of our quarterbacks, number 11, I believe he is. He's going to have a great day today.
All right, terrific. Coach, thanks so much. Best of luck in the game.
Awesome, thank you so
much. All right, back to you guys.
Thank you, Jack.
You're totally
108 to go here in the first game here in the fourth quarter, as the red team with the 21-7 lead. Filardi looks to throw, going to roll out. Try and connect over the middle. That just misses as he was trying to go ahead and hook up with Brunson, and a little bit high and wide on that one.
And it helps out Team White because it saves a timeout. There are 2 timeouts left, and now they get the ball back with a chance to put another touchdown on the board.
So they will send Faulkner out and give the White offense a chance for another score here, as you said. Of course, seeing both teams, you may be hearing both teams warming up right now. believe they'll do some field warm-ups beforehand, but probably trying to stretch out and take that element out of the equation. Bautner's kick, end over end, going to be fielded just across the 40-yard line at the 38 by Charles Robinson, and that's where the White will scrimmage from with just under a minute to go here in regulation. Seen some very good things so far in this contest. We'll see who comes out to play quarterback. I believe it's going to be Ben Tauber again.
I want to see Tauber get out here and just wing the ball down the field, to start throwing the football. We've seen his arm. We've seen how well he can do running the football. He had a great throw on the flag route on the last drive. I want to see him to continue to throw the football in this crucial end-of-game situation.
Tauber, slant pattern, incomplete. Was looking to hook up with Cameron Wicks.
Get what you asked for. Get it because you asked for it. Comes out, wings the football. Live arm right there by Tauber. And you want to see, again, a guy that has the running skill set that he has start to develop as a passer. And he's in this game for a reason. He's a really good player. But that's something I'm going to be watching as we move forward throughout the course of his high school career.
Second and 10. Tauber looking to go deep this time. Incomplete. Was looking to find Brennan Richardson out in the flat and just couldn't do it.
Yeah, you want Richardson to take a better track on that that route. That's the wheel route that we've seen both teams run a lot today. You want to take that outside track so that way he has a chance to drop it in the bucket. He took the inside track to where it made the throw tougher for Tauber.
Tauber, four wide receivers this time. Back next to him, that's Richardson. He's going to hand it off to Richardson up the middle, get a positive gain. Spinning forward, stays on his feet. He'll be brought down after a gain of 8. And Coach Merritt waving his guys up, say, hey, we got to move with a little bit of pace.
A little up-tempo right here, but good run right there by Richardson.
Hand off to Richardson. He'll be hit and brought down, and I think he's short, and that should do it, as the red team should get the ball on downs after a stop by their defense.
Yeah, that was a pretty good stop. Once again, red team doing what they have to do, getting off the ball. And it looks like Brian Bond was in the mix as far as disrupting that play as well.
Actually, you're going to say it's a first down. Looked like from the original spot he didn't get there, but they say first down. So 8 seconds left. The white team's going to get at least one more play, and they'll run the clock right here. Tauber looking deep, trying to hook up. That one's not going to be completed. Threw it way out of bounds, looking for Johnson down the sidelines. And that's going to do it as the clock strikes 0 in our first of our three development games in the books, as the red team beats the white team 21-7 in what was a good show of strength by the red squad, Emery.
Absolutely. You saw in that last play, Brian Bond once again disrupting the throw, forcing him to go deep down the sideline and made it an inaccurate pass, ending the game how he started it with a big play.
Yeah, and again, seeing the teams shaking at midfield, and again, this is about development and all kinds of good things, but again, about USA football, you see the board of directors and so many big names there, like Carl Peterson, of course, the former Kansas City Chiefs defensive lineman, Kansas City Chiefs general manager, I should say, Mark Murphy of the Green Bay Packers, also played for the Washington Redskins. Grant Taff, of course, as well. Wonderful board of directors. Of course, our production crew, great job on our first game. We see it today, all their hard work. Looking very good, this broadcast we're able to bring to you. Again, for Emery Hunt, I'm Jeremy Huber. Your final score, the red team beats the white team 21-7 here at the USA Development Games.